Oh, is anyone out there? If you're reading this, then please respond. Is anyone out there? Hello? This is pointless. Help! Please respond. This is Moth Resistance Cell 12. Mayday! Mayday! We need help! Hello? This is Moth Resistance Cell 12. Our rations are down to the last packets of soybeans. And if the few that are left would rather die than eat soy. Hello? We have lost all communication with the outside world. I'm going to assume that we are the last of the humans. It's just us now. Except, last week we found a human survivor while scavenging on the overworld. They died, as they were pretty beat up. But they told us of someone we had already heard whispers about. The one who might save us all. If these stories are true, then he is our only hope for humanity. Where are you, Cap? We need you. Please help! Hello? Hello?
2020. It has only been a year since the Moth People invasion. All governments and social systems had fallen to their rule. They were now an unstoppable force. The humans worked out all too late and that it was their emotions that had been their downfall. Somehow, the Mothmen were able to sense this with their superior moth radar and take over their victims' minds. However, there was one who had not yet fallen or been captured for slavery. His extensive skills and strategic thinking made him realize that staying inside and talking to no one IRL would be his best bet for survival. I mean, well, he did this anyway. He also had mastered a unique ability, the ability to control his human emotions. Only he could save humanity from the brink of collapse from the evil Moth People. Not even the Power Rangers could stop them now. He was Captain External.
Moron! Dumb. It's on you. Stupid. You're not a strategic thinker.
Oh, God.
Meanwhile, in the city center, giant Moth People run rampant, destroying the city.
You are no match for me, pesky humans. What will you do? Cower in fear. The Moth People are here. Oh no, Captain External.
Fucking acting retarded.
Well, you are no match for me, Captain. I am a giant Mothman, and you are a petty human. What can you do?
You're not a strategic thinker. You don't know what the fuck to do. When I asked you... Dumb nigger. When I asked you...
What are you doing? Hey, stop that.
When I asked you...
How?
When I asked you... When I asked you... This is fucking autistic, and I'm not putting up with anymore. Because my IQ is going down. Separate.
The moth people were finally retreating back due to Captain External's advances. Down in the bunker, the moth people were coming up with a cunning plan to try and stop him.
Supreme Mothman number one. Captain External has defeated Giant Mothman number 12. What are we gonna do? Everything we have tried is not stopping him. It's only a matter of time before Captain External finds us and destroys us all.
But we've already tried that, Mothman Supreme. What else can we do against Captain External? Yes? Well, I tried that as well. Nothing is working. What are we going to do?
Wait. Mothman Supreme. I think I may have the answer. We were going through the Uway's archives. And we found this here recording. It breaks down his character. We may be able to find his weakness finally. Yes, master. We shall play it and discover Captain External's weaknesses once and for all. Yeah, right, I'll play it now. Okay. Yep.
Naturally in life, you're never going to be perfect at what you're striving to be. And you should always strive to be better than what you are.
Well, so yeah. I mean, throughout life. And that's why we're having this conversation now. I would have ended with his interview if I didn't think that there was a bit of hypocrisy in his behavior after the interview when he's saying all these things. I'm not saying that he should have changed his behavior because of my interview, but what I am saying is he said things in that interview that seemed like he was prepared to take fault and admit that his actions are wrong. Well, if you're admitting and that he's learned a lot, well, if those things were true, why is he still doing the same bloody things? Why is he still blocking people? Why is he still disassociating?
Yeah. In the interview, he's talking about unblocking everybody, right?
Mm.
I'm going to unblock everybody. You know, this stuff isn't going to get to me anymore. Well, he never said it got to him. He said, if I remember the phrasing correctly, it was something along the lines of not let it get to him as much. That's where the stoicism comes into play.
Yeah.
And that's where, I mean, I don't think he's being honest with himself.
Well, it finally got to him that enough that he wanted to go on Cogstream. But the intent of going on Cogstream was to try and end it. Was to try and get everything to stop.
So. Well, it wasn't... That obviously wasn't the case. If anything, it fanned the flames.
Yeah.
But at the same time, him going on that stream... let people know that they weren't really going to get any answers out of them. There's a fun aspect to the chaos and the unmoderated, you know, just everybody comes in and, you know, there's madness to it.
Yeah.
It's like an open VC. Like, people will just come in and there's a chaos to it. And there's fun to that. But if you're trying to reach some sort of resolution with somebody, limiting the dogpiling, moderating it so that points can come across and a line of questioning can reach a conclusion, I think that's valuable.
The other problem is Uway talks the way he talks, like in the interview with me, totally non-confrontational, but just he just can't answer questions. Like you ask a question and all of a sudden he's just off on some tangent about some very little specific thing that kind of relates to what you've asked, but he's not looking at the big picture and the fundamentals of what that question is. And I kind of, at the end, I kind of got better. I think the best way with Uway to really get to the truth would be to ask him a yes-no question. A very basic one where really there is only a yes-no and he can't really say too much more about it. Then from that, depending on if he picks yes or no, then move on to another yes-no question. He's like, okay, well, you answered yes to this. Now we're going to, so what about this then? Okay, and then keep building that up until you get to the truth, because just because of the way he talks. Because Cog says it's the salesman. I always said it was a word salad. Other people have called it semantics. A lot of people have called him out online and these little lies because he just says so many, all the shit just comes out of his mouth. You know, it's just so much of this blah, blah, blah. You just talk about all these little things that went on and all this stuff that was happening over here and go down on total different rabbit holes for like 5 minutes. And yeah. So you just got so much to pick up on.
Yeah, the semantics thing is what spurred on the initial argument with Blue, you know.
Yeah.
He said something. He said, Blue Waffle is not a strategic thinker. And he when I listened back to the audio, he started saying something else. But I think I cut him off and I said, did you just call Blue a dumb nigga? And he said, maybe.
Yeah. he explains the offensive, context.
And he explains what he meant, right?
Yeah.
Which is fine. During that stream, I didn't catch the maybe. I would have drilled in on that.
Yeah.
I would have absolutely drilled in on that. Because that's, like, that is damning more than anything else in that audio. I can't believe I missed. I was probably laughing too hard.
Blue caught up on
it. But, you know, he kept circling back and saying the same thing over and over again. And he kept saying, stop interrupting me and let me explain. And he would say the same fucking thing.
I know. Yeah, until you got so angry that you said, dude, you said the same fucking thing 10 times when he started yelling at you. I need to explain it.
I wasn't angry at that point. I'm just like tired of him fucking repeating himself and then him getting mad at me interrupting him. Like, I'm going to interrupt you because you keep saying the same stupid shit.
Mm.
And you're not addressing what I'm asking you.
Yeah, he couldn't get it.
It got to the point where I repeated what he said verbatim.
Mm.
Like, what was going on? As closest to my memory as I could at the time. And looking back on it, I think I was pretty fucking close.
Yeah.
And he would not. I was like, tell me where I'm wrong if I'm wrong. If you think that's not exactly what you said, then tell me what you said that was different. And he wouldn't answer. I yelled at him in Cog stream, too, because he kept saying the same stupid shit over and over again. And then kept yelling about getting interrupted.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm going to fucking interrupt you. You keep interrupting me, trying to get you to expand on something. You interrupt me to say the same stupid shit that you've said.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's like he doesn't acknowledge or compute what the question was fundamentally. It's very odd. Because he will start answering straight away. And it's just a bunch of words and all this stuff comes out. And you're just like, and you're sitting there thinking, and it's like, okay, well, this is kind of important, but it's not really what I asked. That's all I was thinking.
Yeah, I mean, he'll dance around something and not give direct answers.
But is he doing it?
I think that's what frustrates people the most.
Yeah, it does.
I think it is. It's a form of a defense mechanism to avoid him getting cornered and being forced to answer a question that would prove him wrong, essentially.
In Cogstream, yes. In my interview, I don't know. I felt like the interview he was trying to be sincere, but that his way of talking and his way of answering questions was just is just very odd.
I think it's a comprehensive thing to a degree. And a closed-minded thing. He'll hear something and interpret it as something in his mind and then answer what he thinks the question was, which it wasn't. Right? Like, for example, back to the original argument. But I'm saying that's not what you initially said. And I had to clarify this to him, too, and he still refused the answer to acknowledge it. And whether he means to come off this way or not, there's a consistency with how it's being interpreted from the people that are around him.
Yeah.
And is that a Uway issue or is it an everybody else issue? I think we know the answer to that.
Oh, yeah. That's it.
But in that fight, he said something so that was telling, because he would refuse to answer this, acknowledge what I was saying, which was, you're arguing right now about your meaning, what you meant to say. We understand what you meant to say, but that's not what you initially said. And what you initially said is easily interpretable as you essentially questioning the intellectual capabilities of Blue. Because to tell somebody that they're not a strategic thinker basically means that you can't puzzle shit together. You have no foresight. You can't plan. Which means that you're kind of fucking stupid.
Yeah. Something in the developmental process you usually get when you're about 8 to 10 years old, depending on male and female.
Yeah.
Is when you get critical thinking skills. That's basically it. Yeah. You lack critical thinking skills.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Which is insulting. And that's what I was trying to get. I had to say that to him. And he just refused to acknowledge it. So it came to a point where I said, you just can't bear being wrong. And he said, yeah, I hate being wrong. So you just won't admit it. And he ignored that. That was a little tell that I picked up along the way.
Mm.
He will not admit when he's wrong, which is a sign of, his immaturity, which is very prevalent through this entire story. I mean, it ties into so many things. And there's something that he said in your interview with him that I never picked up on, because this is one of his little white lies. He's talking about not having somebody to provide him with the guidance that he needs in order to figure out his way through life. So he has to look to these great thinkers throughout history, right?
Yeah.
So that makes me think either he was raised by a single mother, his father was absent, something along those lines, which makes sense to me.
So we have learned much from this recording. It seems that Captain External is not a great critical thinker. Even though that's why he got into a fight with a pesky human in the first place. Also, he never likes to be wrong. Also, it seems he might choose to try and follow a bunch of principles from books because he had a difficult childhood.
But how does that help us defeat Captain External?
I'm not sure. More analysis of this recording is required.
Like months ago, right? When I first started talking to him and going onto his streams, he would talk about these philosophical ideas and principles. And you talk about, what is the essence of a man? Like, what makes a man? And these other, like Stoicism, for example. Like that's interesting stuff. Like it's stuff that I've thought about. It's stuff that I was raised around. You know, my dad taught me this shit. You know, my dad's into Greek philosophy. We're Greek, so he taught me that. As you know, at a very young age, he's been beating the shit into my head since I was a kid. So he's studying these principles, these Stoic principles, right? And there's a way that he phrases things that lets me know that he doesn't understand it. And he's talking about, you're supposed to do this. They say that you should do this. So what I pick up on from that is that it's like he's seeing these bullet points. And this is something that I said in the plate audio. You're following these bullet points, and it's almost like you don't know why. You don't know what they're supposed to do, what the purpose of them are. Mm-hmm. You don't have an understanding of what these principles are. So, for example, when he said, hope for the best and prepare for the worst. And an example of him doing that was envisioning in his mind the worst outcome as clearly as he could. That's not what the purpose of that is. The purpose of that, of practicing that, is to understand that the worst outcome is a possibility, and you need to be prepared for that outcome. And you cannot worry about that outcome, because worrying about that outcome does you no good. That is an aspect that you cannot control. That's an aspect in your life that what he would refer to as an external. You have no control whether it's going to rain on your wedding day. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So what's the point in worrying about it? All you can do is prepare for it by having tents, for example. Right?
Yep.
Not sitting there and envisioning in your mind like some sort of self-torture, you know. And his example was him being a lolcow, which I found funny because, God forbid, people laugh at you on the internet. Like, who gives a fuck? And, I mean, this is something that you said too. Like, just why not just go somewhere else in the internet? Like, you don't have to deal with this shit. And this ties into other things that he said, where he's his best online. He can be his ideal. And that's, so he's developed this online persona, this envisionment of his best self, which makes a lot of sense to all of the other shit that he's done. So he's built up this ego for himself with a tie to this online persona.
Yeah, and you weigh his identity, and that's why I can't walk away from it.
Yes, because he would be losing, essentially. To him, that ego, his best, would be a failure. He has a very fragile ego. And that's why he reacts the way that he does with things. So he's built up this best self version of himself online. And it bleeds over into the exaggerations about how many girls he's had sex with, how much money he's made, how successful he is, how well educated he is. I could tell by speaking with him that he's not a well educated individual.
Yeah. Because I'm quite well educated, but I don't go on about it.
No, you don't sound like a retard either. Like, he says really stupid, incomprehensible things. But to just out of nowhere talk about how well educated and well read you are when you're in a drama community online, like, that's a red flag. Like, quit bullshitting.
Yeah.
Why are you talking about, like, why are you bragging about how well educated you are? Why are you bragging about how many girls you've slept with? Why are you bragging about how much money you have in the bank? Nobody cares, and nobody believes you when you say it.
Yeah. It's like bringing your real life stuff in and saying, well, look how great I am because of these. And I'm better than you online because of this, but really it has nothing to do with online as well. Online, it's about your rep. It's this identity. You've got an identity, like your avatar and your identity and all of that, and somewhat a brand, I guess, kind of.
The only thing you have online is your reputation.
Yeah. And just what you say, yeah, and that's it. This digital voice, that's it. Everything else is bullshit.
Being, there's a consistency with your character online. And when there's inconsistencies, people call you on it. I mean, you've seen it happen over and over again, especially in this corner of the internet, I guess. This drama community, I guess. It sounds cringy to say it like that, but what else are you going to call it? If you're being dishonest, you're going to fuck up because you're not going to remember your lie. You always remember the truth. So you either don't speak on it or tell the truth, because somebody with an autistic fucking memory like myself is going to hear that and say, hey, motherfucker, that's not what you said before. Why did you change the story now? Unless you're lying. And that's what happened with Uwe. He's built up this ego, this persona, right? He hates being wrong. He's stubborn. He is. He thinks himself smarter than everybody in the room, when in fact, that's far from the truth. His narcissism tied to his ego. I don't even know if it's narcissism more than just self-centeredness. Closes off his ability to see things from other perspectives, because I mean that opens up his vulnerability of being wrong. He can't bear that he's wrong, even though, it comes to a point where he has to apologize for stuff, but it's not he won't fully apologize for.
But he says he's sincere when he makes... I wrote it down before, because you said he doesn't like to admit fault, but then he finally takes blame in the interview, and he has done at other points.
He does.
He admits that he's been passive-aggressive with his blame, blaming others for his actions. And then when he says he makes an apology, he's been sincere, and I believe him when he says that, but... then he doesn't change any of his... he hasn't changed any of his actions. He's still doing the exact same thing. Do you think he's been sincere when he makes an apology? Because he says that he is. From his perspective.
I think the insincerity of it comes from where he says that he has done absolutely everything that he could to make it, to apologize. And that's not the case. If you want to make a sincere apology to somebody, you say it to their face. I mean,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
For lack of better words, we're not talking face to face, but this is what is as close as it's going to get online.
Yeah.
If you want to apologize to somebody, you talk to them directly. You don't say it to them in your YouTube chat.
Well, maybe.
You don't post it on Twitter. Like that shows a level of insincerity.
Yeah.
If you meant it, you would call me and you would fucking tell me.
Yeah, but that's cool. Yeah,
still
I get
holding
that.
On to a little something there.
Mm.
You're not letting go of something. You're holding back.
And then you break down what an apology is. An apology isn't just the words, it's the actions that come after those words. Like the actual definition of someone apologizing in a sincere way would mean that there's not just there's a statement or some sort of word said that says I'm sorry and this is what I did wrong, but then there's some sort of action to try and fix that. And a proper apology would be to try and better yourself and make the situation better. And he hasn't done that.
I mean, that would be ideal.
Yeah. Well, that would be the perfect. That would be what an apology is. And I think what happened is. He thinks he's sincere. He puts some words up on Twitter, or he says it in my interview, but then there's no actions. His actions are totally different. His actions are the exact same thing that he's been doing the whole time that's caused all the bullshit in the first place, which is further disassociations. Or he says in my interview he's going to unblock or unban people, but then he just goes and straight up blocks them again. Or he lets them into a Discord with no roles so that all they can do is lurk. Well, what good's that?
Yeah.
Like, where's the action to actually become better?
Well, I mean, you can give somebody, you know, a heartfelt, sincere apology. And, you know, if there's a promise to change tied to it, that's, I feel like that's where that comes in.
I think that's part of apologizing, though. Yeah.
I think, I mean, for the ideal, yeah. But you can give somebody a sincere apology and then...
And then keep doing the same thing again.
Well, I mean, you can fuck up again. You know, and that could be forgivable to, you know, until it reaches a certain point. I think another level to it that makes it feel insincere is that he never explains what he's apologizing for. I haven't heard him say why he disassociated with Blue.
Good luck getting that answer.
I know.
There isn't.
That's where the insincerity comes from. You don't. What are you apologizing for? Are you apologizing because you feel sorry that this is the outcome of your actions? Or are you actually sorry for doing something specific? And that's where, I mean, that's like, for example, the apology that he made to Stretch on Twitter. It was worded in a way that it was like, I apologize that you feel this way. Not, I apologize for doing this to you.
Yeah.
And you know.
But you talk to Uwe and he feels sincere about that apology and said that he meant it. And then he gets upset and puts up the defenses because Cog and everybody else is now breaking down that apology and calling out it as bullshit. But then at the same time, he won't talk to Stretch. Stretch has handed out olive branch after olive branch. So who's really right in this situation? It's obvious. If Stretch is making an attempt to do it. And Stretch put it a good way, and I've put it in part three. It says that he said that the real answer is he got him all emotional and couldn't handle it anymore, and so he disassociated with people in the heat of the moment. That's the answer. He just won't say it. He'll try and give all these reasons and go on tangents. And sometimes maybe he's saying things because he thinks that's what people want to hear. So he gives this 5-minute presentation on all these different aspects to how Stretch did him wrong. Or 20 minutes, if you look at Cogstream. He talks for a good 20 minutes about and cannot give a single reason as to why he disassociated with Stretch in particular. Yeah. And really... Well, that's because it really was probably the real answer, which you can't get out of Uwe, is he got all emotional and in the heat of the moment, in a big huff, decided he was done with this shit. And he's like, well, if you're going to be all mean, I'm going to go. Like a 4-year-old.
And
you're being mean, I'm going to run to teacher. Sort of thing.
Yeah.
But if you just think about it as such a simple action, it makes sense.
Oh, it is very simple. And this is something that you mentioned in the interview with him and ties back to, you know, when you were in part two and you're explaining his stoic principles, right? And this is why he's behaving this way. It's because he's trying to adhere to these principles as he interprets them. And... in the interview, I believe you say that you were trying to explain to people how he wasn't just ass blasted about stuff. I mean, in reality, when it boils down to it, that's exactly why he disassociated with people. He felt slighted. And instead of confronting the situation, maybe trying to resolve it and reaching a middle ground. Yeah, I was wrong here. I felt that you slighted me here, you know, level things out like an adult. He throws a tantrum and says, I'm never talking to you again. Why? You know what you did, or I don't have to explain it to you. What the hell? What? What do you mean? I don't even know what happened. I don't owe you an explanation.
Yeah.
What? And that ties back into the fragility of his ego. You know, it would expose what these behaviors are actually a part of, and it's, you know, his insecurities. Like, I got really sensitive that you said that, and so my knee-jerk reaction was to say, "I'm never talking to you again." He's paranoid that everyone's out to get him. It ties into his, you know, his self-centeredness. He can't think outside of his little bubble that he's created for himself. He refuses to even look at other people's perspectives because he thinks that people are trying to trick him. And he thinks he's smarter than they are. And he's seen through their plan, their evil plan.
Mm.
And that they're working together behind the scenes to take him out. But he won't ask himself, why? Why are people trying to take you out? You're not important enough, dude. Nobody fucking cares.
So he would be a locale on Kiwi Farms because he thinks that locales go on Kiwi Farms. So that's where he has to be forgotten. That's where his lore has to go there at some point. It's like, oh, I'm a locale. Oh, when's my Kiwi Farm thread coming? It's like, Kiwi Farms doesn't give a fuck, dude.
Yeah, like, oh, you're trying to turn me into a locale. Like, the fact that he said that immediately let me know that he has no idea what the fuck a locale is.
And that he is one.
You can't be turned into a locale. You're fucking born that way, dude. Like, I don't know what to tell you. Like, you're either one or you're not. You can't be, like, turned into one.
Like, either. Well, you turn yourself into one for your own actions.
Yeah, well, that's somebody else can't. Like, I can't troll somebody into becoming a lolcow. Their behavior is what's going to make them a lolcow.
Yeah.
So if I prod somebody and they react a certain way, I'm like, oh shit, he's a fucking spurg. All right, let's keep trying this. And then, like, they spiral completely out of fucking control. And then they start thinking about these conspiracies that are against them. And everybody's out to get them. But I'm going to stand strong and fight this battle to the death because I'm not going to succumb to your desires of driving me off the internet.
Yeah. Yeah, that's such a good point. Nuts? It's a good analogy.
So, Captain External is paranoid due to his self-centeredness and unable to make sincere apologies. Well, those aspects don't really help us.
But how does that help us defeat Captain External?
Don't worry, my fiendish moth friend. Because this concept of being an external, this might help in our battle against the Captain. Now, let's keep listening and see if we can find out more about this stoicism.
So there's him on Esau's stream saying Geek Fulu is a pedo, yes, when everyone else is just saying it's creepy. Then you've seen him talk about Worski, where he's saying, you know, well, Worski's just full of shit, and he can't even come on here, and he can't make an apology, and...
Yeah, and he hates Worski because he's a pussy.
Yeah.
Because he won't step up to...
And he's blaming everybody else, yet himself. And exactly. So he goes, the main thing is here is he's just full of shit, and so... Why even bother with him? It's over, you know? And he's so passionate about it. And you just sort of, yeah, but you look at that clip now. And I did it. I mean, I went and grabbed it and I just changed all the times it said Worski, or he said Worski, to Uway.
Yeah.
And it just fits perfect. It's just
the same exact thing when he went on Ralph's stream.
Mm-hmm.
When he went on there and he called Ralph a pussy for not, you know, not basically taking on his critics, not being willing to even listen to the criticism without kicking somebody out of his, you know, off the show. call him a pussy for that.
Huh?
But yeah, then it's like, but you wait, you won't even let people come on the show to present the criticism. Like, Andy Worski knew that you were going to come on his show and give him shit. And you came on his show, he let you on the show, and you gave him shit. Like, I trolled the shit out of Andy Worski, and he'll still talk to me in the VC. And Uwe despised him for being a pussy. What does that make you, if not a bigger fucking pussy than Andy Worski? And then to sit here and say that you're not being a pussy and a coward?
Mm. Yeah, he says...
And you're a fucking hypocrite to boot.
And he'll go on many tangents to say how it's different or something. Because in his case, the punishment didn't fit the crime or something. And it's just like, dude... He kept saying how it was about the car soccer thing, and that's what, and he keeps going on about it. It's like, Uwe, you're the only one that goes on about the fucking strategic thinking thing, really.
He's the only as one the main that point. That.
Yeah, that's really held on to it. That's really adamant on it. It's not about, it's the VC afterwards where you're talking to Cog and you disassociate with everybody, tell them the stream's private, and then tell everyone to go fuck themselves and just listen and believe, and then leave Cog's head spinning. And then he's like, yeah, but Cog was supposed to read my mind and know that 24 hours later I would be back with answers.
Yeah, I lied to Cog with the intention of telling him the truth that night. How is Cog supposed to know that you, A, that you lied to him, and B, that you were planning on coming back and telling him the truth?
It doesn't even make sense.
It doesn't. And I believe...
I couldn't get the answer. That I do believe first that night, he lied in you hear me in the recording. It's just like, why did you do that, though? I just don't get this. Why did you tell that?
Like, my jaw hit the fucking floor. Like, what? That's a rationalization to you?
Hmm.
That just... So, in other words, Cog was 100% fucking right to do that stream.
Yeah.
And that's what is the major betrayal?
Yeah.
That he didn't come to you. According to Cog and everybody else in that VC, you disassociated with him.
Yeah, but I finally worked out what he meant when he says he never disassociated. Because if he had disassociated with Cog, then how was he supposed to go back 24 hours later to tell him what the truth now was? For some strange reason. That's why he said, that's why he's adamant he never disassociated with Cog in that VC. That's the reason. Because, you know, he had to tell him the truth. He had
plans of coming back and talking to him.
That's it.
Which the whole thing boggles my mind.
I know. And doesn't matter. Like, when you think about the fact that, well, he disassociated with him the very next day and fucking was on his own stream just going off about how Cog's a fucking arsehole and how it's really opened his eyes and it was so fucking butthurt. And he felt, when and I get it, justified. He felt that it was unfair for Cog to go and do a stream about something so small, yet. Yeah, but it wasn't about that. He keeps thinking it's about the strategic thinking and being mean to Blue. It's about all the disassociations and how you treated Cog and everybody else in that VC, and the fact that you would just go and flip out over something so minor.
Yeah,
that you can't even handle it, and it shows.
You kept mentioning, you know, that the disassociation with Blue was a heat of the moment thing, but it absolutely wasn't. He slept on that. Like, that happened the night before. The end of that stream, everybody was cool. Like, it was fine. It was funny. You know, there was absolutely an argument. But people argue and are fine. In the plate conversation, Roxo says, Uwe, you're making ad hoc rationalizations for things.
And I was just thinking that, yeah.
And
similar, not
like you're coming up with justifications for your behaviors that you feel rationalize your actions after the fact.
Mm-hmm.
when we can all see that that's not what happened. That's not what was going on. Right?
Yeah, that's it.
You're rationalizing lying to Cog because your intention, because you had the intent of coming back and telling him the truth. Like, so you still lied to him. He didn't even know that you lied to him there. So you just gave him a bullshit story about hiding the stream because you were afraid of the trolls and then refusing to give it to him. Hmm. All that looks like is that you're trying to hide the stream because something fucking happened there, and all you're telling Cog, listen and just, you know, believe me. Then why won't you show it to me?
Yeah.
I'm disassociating from you. Like, what, you fucking nuts? Like, what happened in this argument that's so bad that you had to come into this VC and start talking about how you're disassociating from Blue Waffle?
Yeah, that's it.
I'm not telling you. The response is, I'm not telling you? The fuck?
And then
Stretch is like, why are you being a bitch? Now I'm disassociating from you. What?
And then...
like, what are you, fucking nuts?
Yeah, I'm
lying. Crazy shit. Of course Cog's gonna do a stream on that.
Yeah, I know. I put that forward in the interview. I was just like, well, look at it from this, and this. Well, of course he's gonna do it. But no.
You knew what your fucking intentions were that night.
Yeah.
And if you're going out with your friends that night, when were you gonna come back and tell them that you were telling the truth?
And he didn't even know how to take a screenshot and all of that. And he didn't ask for help until 24 hours later. When
just fucking Google the goddamn thing. It's the simplest shit in the world.
But it wasn't his suggestion to make a screenshot. He didn't... I never actually told this because I didn't really think about it. He didn't come to me and say, hey, can you help me make a screenshot? He came to me and said, Cog's throwing me under the bus. And I was like, what do you mean? And then I said, and then he's like, well, I told him it was private, but it really wasn't. And I was like, why would you do that? Like, what? So you lied to him? Like, what are you doing? Why would you do that? Couldn't get an answer. And then he tells me the whole story. And I said, oh, okay, well, this is what you need to do. You need to get a screenshot. Well, you need to video the thing, the fact that it's blocked, and just put that out. You know how it's part of his story now that he was always going to get a screenshot or not? He never brought that up. It was me that said he had to do it 24 hours later.
This is the shit with him coming together with this fucking story after the fact.
Mm.
To try to do damage control. First of all, your story doesn't make any fucking sense.
I know, and he still does it. Yeah. Because, okay, he look still at... does it. Like, FTW, I go on FTW's show instead of him because he won't go. I said, look, he's disassociated with Blue, and I can't work out why. I get a message as soon as I say those words. Within 20 seconds, I get a message. I never kicked Blue from the Discord. I was like, oh, okay, whatever. So he didn't disassociate with Blue. Maybe I've got it wrong. And then I probably said that on stream as well. But he had disassociated with Blue.
Yeah.
Just hadn't booted him from the Discord or something.
His mind, he's got this weird definition for what disassociating with somebody is.
Yeah, in the interview, I'm going to unblock everyone, but I'm not going to pay attention to them. I'm letting everybody back into the Discord, but I'm not giving them active roles. Didn't say that, did he? Oh, I'm going to get over this, and I'm totally apologetic. Well, he's not going to talk to anyone. Yeah.
In his stream today, he said, I am not unblocking a single person. No matter what.
So he's gone back on exactly what he said only a few days ago.
Yeah, he said that yesterday. He said the interview
was bullshit. And that's the thing. And I think, okay, fundamentally, out of the whole thing with everything, everybody's getting a laugh out of this is one thing. Yeah, okay. Everyone's having a laugh. It's a dumpster fire. It's good fun. There's that side. There's the banter and the trolling. But fundamentally, like in these lore videos, in these interviews, and with everyone I've spoken to, everyone is there, and everybody that's trying to communicate with Uway is trying to get him to understand and become a better person. Everyone's coming at from that perspective.
Yes. Essentially, yes. And as much fun as I've made of him, because he's a goofy fuck, he's a cringy goofy fuck. As much fun as I've made of him, I have bent over fucking backwards to give that idiot the best advice that I could to dig himself out of this hole.
Everybody has, including Cog.
And he is so fucking paranoid.
Including Plays.
Yes. Everybody.
Every single person.
Has tried to give him the right advice on what to do. And either he's too fucking stupid, or he's so fucking paranoid that he thinks that it's some sort of trap.
Every single person tries to beat it into his head. This is what you need to do. We are trying to help you. We're trying to throw out olive branches. We're trying to make this better. Come and talk to us. You know, let's work this out. He just won't.
And, I mean, even when he goes back and he listens to this, because he's going to listen to it, I guarantee you that he's going to think that this is some sort of fucking long con on my behalf. But I'm saying this to you to try to trick him.
Oh, no.
Like, how fucking stupid can you be? Like, take me out of the fucking equation and look at the advice that I'm giving you.
Yeah.
Think about it.
With your
logical, stoic mind, right? Think about, logically process what the fuck I'm saying to you. Does that not sound like a good goddamn idea to get this shit off your back? Like, why don't you go individually to each person on your own stream? Bring one person on and resolve it. If they're a fucking dickhead, if you feel like they're trying to make a mockery of you, kick them.
No.
Like, nobody was trolling you before. Nobody was making fun of you before. It's because of what you did that people started fucking with you. It's because of what you did that people started calling you out on your bullshit. People started digging through your old streams to find the cringy shit that you said. Because everybody knew that you were saying cringy shit. They let it slide. MGTOW gives him an out. And this ties into the ad hoc rationalizations. It gives him an out. This ideology provides him an out and an excuse for his shortcomings. Whether he's an incel or he has an issue with commitment, right? I mean, personally, I think he's an incel. Let's say he's had some girlfriends, right? Something happened somewhere along the way. He is incapable of committing. MGTOW provides him, it's like a puzzle piece for him to fit in, to cover up that hole. And with the stoicism, you know, this self-control, this indifference to, you know, the ability to control your emotions in a situation, you know, the courage in the face of emotional distress, let's say, right? That's a big aspect of stoicism, right? You're in where somebody that doesn't have control over their emotions would wig out, you know, and freak out, get overly offended, and just be super emotional about shit. Stoicism, practicing stoicism, being a stoic, you wouldn't let that shit get to you. Because there's no benefit to having that emotional reaction. The way he's interpreted stoicism is that, you know, I'm just going to let this go. I'm going to move on. I don't need to address it. It doesn't matter to me. Right?
Yeah.
When in reality, it absolutely matters to him. He is upset about these things. He does not want to face the fact that he's fucking wrong, and he does not want to have those words. He does not want to say, I did this specific thing. I fucked it up. And this is a shortcoming of mine. You know, this is where I've failed. He says, I've failed. Where? He doesn't tell you. He says, I did you wrong. Where? He doesn't tell you. He will not fucking admit it. He cannot admit it to himself, and he cannot admit it to anybody else. What those specific things are, and his interpretation of stoicism gives him an out to not have to explain that, to not go into it. Or he'll tell me in chat, don't cross that line again or I'll ban you. And I say, what's the line? You know what the line is. No, I don't. I'm asking you because I don't know. I'm not going to explain. I'm not talking about this anymore. You don't know what the fucking line is, dude. You're just butthurt because I made fun of you on a stream. You're mad that I outed you for being a fucking liar because he's a liar. This is the final thing I want to go into on him. That motherfucker outright lies. And this is what made me really fucking mad on that COG stream. When I was gone from the stream, he called me out. I wasn't in chat, nothing. He said, I'm calling out Hef to prove that that's what I said. Because he doesn't have the fucking proof and he's a liar. I came back and Trez was in there and she saw me pop up in the chat and she said, hold on, Hef, Uway called you out to show these DMs. Because he knows that it didn't take place in DMs. It took place in a private voice call. And he also uses that to call me a liar because he knows that I don't have proof of it because I didn't record him. I don't think he's done anything as direct as what he did to me on that fucking stream. So when he called me out on the DMs, I hopped in. I'm like, what fucking DMs are you calling me out on, motherfucker? Like, what are you trying to call me out to be a liar on? And he's like, the DMs where I said I'm disassociating from COG. I said, that wasn't in DMs. I was in a voice call, and you fucking know it. So he's like, oh, COG, you're wrong. I'm like, why would COG know about where our conversation took place?
Because he couldn't prove it. Yeah, he said, well...
Because he knew that there wasn't any fucking evidence of it.
I couldn't believe it. He started saying how he was right because you couldn't prove it.
Yeah.
He called me a liar in that stream, too. He said that because he threatened to disassociate with me, and he said that was total bullshit, because how come we've been talking the whole time? And I said, because I didn't care, and I said, I posted the receipts.
He knew that I didn't have evidence for it. He had previously admitted it. He said it to COG before, that he told COG that he came to me and said that he was going to disassociate with him. So I saved the lying aspect of it to kind of tie a bow on what I'm about to say. He has lied directly. He has lied by saying, trying to come up with this excuse of, misinterpretation. He has lied by using vagaries to try to spin his way out of a situation. With everything that we know about Uway, we know that he's willing to lie. We know that he's exaggerated about shit. My read on the motherfucker is that anything that he has been braggadocious about, like with the girls excitedly, like almost too excitedly jumped into conversations about like his sex life, you can't trust it. It sounds like bullshit. I've got a pretty decent fucking bullshit meter. I think the dude he's a lonely individual just seeking validation from people. He's unsuccessful. He's uneducated. He's immature. He's trapped in this house with his mom, his mother's house. He may look like he's taking care of her because he's the man of the house. His dad isn't around. He's talked about his dad, by the way. His dad's a lawyer, and that his dad's going to protect him from situations that happen if he gets swatted, per se, right? He said that as well.
Right.
He has fallen short of what on at every turn. He's just failed at every fucking turn, and he's come online. He has received some of this positive feedback, and it has inflated his fucking ego to the point where he just kept running with it and running with it and running with it. Until it blew up in his face. And that little taste of what he's been so desperately seeking, he is clinging onto with everything he's fucking got. That's why he won't abandon this persona that he's developed for himself. It's a matter of, I mentioned it before, it's just going to be another fucking failure for him. And that's why he's fighting this tooth and nail. Because if this fails for him, if he comes on here and he presents what he perceives to be the best that he can be, and that fails, I think it'd just be too crushing for him. That's my read on it. I mean,
he hasn't said much, but you sort of get it that his mental health in real life is probably a concern. I don't know.
Well, he's talked about how bleak he sees the world.
Yeah, that he needs these principles in order to live.
And this is where his MGTOW ideology and stoicism are in complete conflict, because he's talking about the state of what's happening to men in society. Men are killing themselves at a higher rate than ever before. Marriage, traditional lifestyle is dead. You have no control over those things. Stoicism, the fucking core element of it is to understand that you don't have any control over it and not fucking sweat it, because you have no ability to affect that. The only thing that you can affect in your life are the things that you have direct control over. Mm-hmm. Like your reputation. Like how you treat people. And if making those too, I mean, that's if he's worried about, oh, trannies are going to be fucking everywhere, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, the LGBT communities run rampant. His fucking, he's swimming in red pill knowledge. Yeah, and he with the MGTOW, he's gotten these black pills dropped on him, right?
Yeah.
If you're a true stoic, if you're trying to lead that lifestyle, a black pill is just going to be another bit of information that you've got that you do not let affect you emotionally, because you have the understanding that there's nothing that you can do about it. So why sweat it? That ties into what I was saying about he doesn't fucking understand what these things are. He's reading bullet points out of a book.
Mm.
And he's just blindly following it. If you just mix the two solutions together, you know that reaction is going to come out, or you expect that reaction to come out. But if you don't understand why, you don't understand the fucking chemistry. And that's his lack of comprehension. He's ties back to him being fucking stupid. He's just dumb.
But how does that help us defeat Captain MGTOW?
I think I have it, my fiendish friend. Quick, we must get back to the leader. Because I think I have the answer on how to defeat Captain MGTOW after all this time. Think about it. Why did he start attacking us when we haven't done anything to him at all? It's because of his passive aggressiveness. All these other people became externals for a reason. All I need to do is some strategic thinking of my own. Quick, back to the leader to enact our cunning plan.
Later that day, Captain MGTOW would turn up as planned to defeat the Moth People once and for all. Little did he know of their strategic thinking.
When I asked you, bro. Oh, God.
Hey, Captain MGTOW, can you describe a vagina for us?
Bro.
Hey, Captain MGTOW, you're a shit goalkeeper.
Hey, Captain External! You gay!
It's on you. This is fucking autistic and I'm not putting up with anymore. Because my IQ is going down.
Yay, it worked. Captain External is leaving us alone. All we had to do was become externals by giving him shit and banter that he couldn't handle. Now we can rule the world in peace. Moth domination is ours! Yay! 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 Yay!
So from listening to the lore archives about Captain External and their strategic thinking, the Moth people realized that Captain External was not attacking them to save humanity. He was just being passive-aggressive and paranoid that the Moth people were only after him. Through the power of sick bants and insults, they had made themselves externals to the captain, so he would no longer fight them, and instead not talk to them anymore, and treat them indifference, and have hurt Fifis. The day was won, and the Moth people could now take over the world and all of humanity in peace and harmony. The reign of the Moth people would strive for the next 2,000 years until the rise of the dinosaur cyborgs. But that is a story for another time.
God. Oh, thank God. It was just some sort of fever dream. Oh, God. I really gotta stop doing all that editing. Fucking Moth people. What the fuck was I thinking? Back to reality.
Stupid. You're not a strategic thinker. Oh, God. It's on you.